an economist, Rachel Griffith is most interested in the way public policy affects people's choices and how it can be used to help them make better choices. One area she's been particularly drawn to is nutrition and high sugar consumption.
As an academic, my role is not to say what policy should be. My role is to say, if these are the objectives that we as a society think that we want to try and achieve, what are the mechanisms that we can use to do that? We have this amazingly rich data, the supermarket scanner data, which had been very exploited in kind of marketing and pricing and merger analysis, competition analysis, but had not really been brought into the arena to think about health. One of the reasons that we focused on sugar is because sugar consumption is incredibly high, well above medically recommended levels, and that it leads to big problems with people's physical and mental health that people themselves aren't taking account of when they decide to consume. So as economists, what we think is that, you know, who's best placed to decide what you should eat? You are. Why should the government tell you what to eat? But if you're, say, a 13-year-old and you're consuming twice as much sugar as the government's recommending, and that's leading you to slightly bug out and not do well at school, which means you're not going to get good grades, which means you're not going to get a good job, which means you're going to have troubles in later life, there's clearly a role for the government to take account of those future consequences.
According to Griffith, there is also a growing body of evidence that poor nutritional decisions greatly affect social mobility and later outcomes in life, especially for those in poor households.
If we think about wanting to protect the most vulnerable people in society and give children a chance to grow up and be productive members of society, that ensuring that they have a reasonably nutritious diet is important. In sugar, that's one of the compelling reasons to think about what kind of policies can we implement that help people make really better choices for them in a more long-run sense.
But changing people's behavior and habits in a constructive way is no easy task. One individual policy change causes something else to adjust, which is why a more holistic set of policies is key.
Food is an intimate part of your entire life. You don't take decisions about what you eat and how you eat in isolation from what else is happening in your life. And so a lot of attention, including my work, has looked at the price of foods. But if you look at what's happened over like the last 30 years, the price of foods has fallen a lot. That's had huge welfare benefits to poor households in particular, for whom food's a big part of their expenditure. So that's like super good news. Poor people can afford to eat much more cheaply than they used to. But people have also said, well, that's one of the driving factors behind rising obesity. And in some of the work we've done, we suggest if you really want to influence people's decision-making in this area, you need to be more holistic about not just a single thing like the price of food, but just about people's entire decision-making process about food and activity.